Up your brown book, baby. It's for you, it's for us. The fantasies, no one can judge us. No one can judge us. This is for us. Open up your brown book, baby. It's for you.
Hey, hey, it's your girl Shay Baby, and welcome to another episode here at the Brown Book Series. Tonight we have an awesome young lady for you. You know me, I'm always going visiting places, child. So I was visiting a place called Jasper Falls, and they was like, "Do you know Miss Lydia Michaels?" And I was like, "I don't see Lydia to come outside and play." And she was like, "Girl, I'm on my way." So tonight we have award-winning bestseller author Miss Lydia Michaels. But first, y'all know what y'all gotta do. Call your friends. Let them know that the Brown Book Series is on, and we're on at a new time. I know y'all peeped that. Y'all like it? Mm-hmm. I know you do. We're on at a new time. Wednesdays now at 7 o'clock. That's us. It's Brown Book Series. The new time is Wednesdays at 7 p.m. All right? So go get your drink. Go call your friends. Let them know that the Brown Book Series is on, and we'll be right back with my new friend, Miss Lydia Michaels.
Brown Book Series presents The Raw Experience. October 28th and the 29th, 2022. It's all going down at the Westin Hotel, Old Town, Alexandria. Not only will you meet and greet with your favorite authors, there's so much more. A live performance by Coco Brown of Fat Cat Players.
Why don't you put on one of those lovely sunglasses that I bought you?
And Grammy Award-winning Regina Bell.
Silver moon shining on my bed, beside my pillow.
Regina Bell, live. Registration is open now at rawexperience.com. RRAWExperience.com.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen. Brown Book Series, please give a big brown book welcome for the first time here at the Brown Book Series, Miss Lydia Michaels. Hi, Lydia.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much for coming and hanging out with us here, girl. We appreciate it. We really appreciate that. Now, Lydia, girl, you know, here at the Brown Book Series, we get all up in your business, honey. We want to know the what's, the when's, the how's. Everything. I want to talk about these McCullough bro. I want to do all that. But first, before we get started, tell everybody a little bit about award-winning the bestseller author Lydia Michaels outside of the literary world. Like, what is it like in a day in the life of Lydia?
Well, I'm a Virgo, so I'm never doing enough.
Hey, I know that's right.
So I just opened an office in Bristol, Pennsylvania. So we're branching out and doing some newer things. I just got my certification as a life coach, and I am so down to working with women, helping women, positive building, going after and accomplishing their dreams. I'm very goal oriented. So outside of when I'm writing, I'm very into that. I also run a retreat annually called Behind the Keys, and I host a great mix match of authors from all different levels, and we kind of collaborate and form a little mastermind, and then we stay close with those authors throughout our journeys, each at different, checkpoints. And other than that, I'm writing. That's my favorite thing in the whole world. My least favorite thing would probably be the marketing aspect of it, but it's a necessary evil. So there's that. That's a big part of my day. And if I'm having the best author day, I'm down at the Jersey Shore, like writing early in the morning, getting out into the sun later in the afternoon, squeezing some yoga in, having drinks at night, and just trying to enjoy and savor every moment.
Girl, I absolutely love it. I gotta start this whole yoga thing. My daughter was like, "Shay, can you get into yoga?" I'm like, I don't know. I got to figure that part out. Like, where do you start? I'm like, is there like a beginning lessons or something?
So my theory is like with yoga, I mean, I love it. I love, love, love yoga. And my favorite place to do yoga is on the beach. So I do it on the beach, like, I think 5 days a week. And then they have nighttime yoga, which is very, like Reiki with the sounds and the they do the whole like bowl things, and it's, they're getting sprinkling voodoo whatever on you, getting your zen on, and I don't know, we leave all peaceful. So,
oh my God, I love it.
Yeah, I mean, like, it just brings you down, and I feel like it's active self-care. So I have a really hard time sitting in a salon. I'm very impatient. Like, I hate sitting through a movie or wasting time. I'm like very time oriented. So like active self-care works for me. It calms me down. It keeps me present. It, you know, and it's good for you. So, but just start like basic. It should not be hard, hard effort. Like you might have like a stretch that you're like, ooh, you know, but it shouldn't be like that. You need to just enjoy it. And it should feel like a massage when you're done, like a workout, but a massage in the end.
Okay. So. We had to talk about that off the air, girl. So you can tell me where to get started at. Cause that sounds good right there. Cause I just be looking at my Peloton bike and I'd be like, you know, we need to do some stretches. Cause that's why I didn't even about to kill me. Cause I'd be like, what is going on?
It should be enjoyable, pleasant.
Yeah, it's like sex, right?
Yeah, a little bit like making love. Like slow, easy, stretching, good, feels good. At the end, you're like, yeah, I feel that.
Okay, need a cigarette? I'm with it. I'm with all of that. Now, Lydia, you are an award-winning best-selling author. So when did you know that writing was your thing, and why romance?
When I started writing, I wasn't writing romance. I was writing like memoir suspense. And it was really hard to sell because I was a terrible writer. And then I realized like, I really love doing this though. So I studied, I originally had a degree in special education. And when I had my daughter, I took all the effort I had and all the energy like into raising her and kind of like renaissancing my own like future, because I just really loved, I fell in love with books and writing, and I was reading so much romance, and I'm dyslexic. So for me, reading was never a pleasure until I discovered romance. At that point, I was just like binging crazy, you know, I mean, I think I read like 400 books that year. I was insane. And for someone who like literally could not read anything but Shel Silverstein growing up, I found the books I loved. And so I started writing, and I was getting rejected on what I was writing, and I was learning as I was going. There were some really great, you know, it's like failing upward, you know, like you get some great feedback, you make connections with people, they advise you, wonderful support in this community. And then my girlfriends were like, why in the world aren't you writing romance? And I was like, I don't know. So I started writing romance, and then it was like, boom, boom, boom. I mean, it just took off. And, you know, I did for my 40th book, I actually wrote a book on all the things I wish I knew in the beginning. So it's this big fat, you know, write 10K in a day, how to.
Yo, so I saw that, right? And I was like, what is the write 10K in a day?
So write 10K in a day is, it's three centric focuses. It's the health and wellness of authors, because I really do feel our industry overlooks that. And it sort of becomes this where authors sort of fall into a funnel where they feel like they're in a puppy mill almost of, you know, write, produce, release, write, produce, release. And that self-care falls to the wayside. And so the first part is all about let's recalibrate and figure out how you're going to do this to find sustainable success long-term. And that starts with taking care of ourselves. So the first part is all about that. The second part is all about the business of writing, because a lot of people say, well, I don't know. And a lot of people come into the book industry thinking it's like $1 million like shot, you're just gonna knock it out and be James Patterson or Nora Roberts. Hey. And that is very wrong. Like there's such a small percentage. And you know, so in the business section, I really break down the book industry struggles with transparency. So yeah. I break down a lot of the statistics that have taken me a long time to gather and find, and they're not updated annually. So that's a struggle too. Where we say like, this is what the average indie author makes. This is the median income for a hybrid author, a traditionally published author. And it's very eye-opening. So it's very important to understand the business you're getting into. And also you might be a great writer, but a terrible business person. So right. Kind of help meld those two things together. Everyone has strong suits. Everyone has weak points. and like giving you advice on where you can get help, what you should be doing for taxes, all of these things for the business thing, because people write a book and they think I'm ready and they're not. Right. So marketing, business, all that. Then the third part is the craft. So I'm very, very prolific. Like I've written best-selling books in under 10 days and they're, you know, full length 400 page novels and award winners. And then, you know, sometimes you write ones that take 3 years, but if there is a formula and you don't have to be a formulaic writer to appreciate that formula. I was a pantser originally, but there is, when you start writing quality stories, there's the linear plot line and you have to understand that. Almost like you don't have to follow it, but you have to have enough common knowledge of it that it's like a rote experience for you to write. So it just sort of comes out of you like breathing or walking and you're not thinking about it, but you are following these so that you're writing to market, but also writing to your heart. So
I love that. I'm over here tripping, Lydia. This is like so freaking cool though. Oh my God, that's hot, because everybody needs that. And you are so right. Just because you're a good author doesn't necessarily mean you're a great business person.
Yeah. I mean, I hate numbers. So at one point in my life, I was like a math teacher and a tutor and all these things. And I don't know how, because once I brought words in, the numbers all fell out. So to sit down and do accounting for me is like, you know, and you know, I always quote like Mark Twain with that, like we all have frogs during the day. And if you have a frog, like something you hate doing, you have to like eat the frog first, you know, and just get it done. And it's all things like that. And I mean, I highly recommend it for authors of all levels. I mean, author Dee Dee Lorenzo told me it was my love letter to writers. And I'm like, I love that, because I do feel
that would be a great gift though. We have to talk, Lydia. We might need to add that to the Brown Book series. It's a swag bag.
Sure, anytime. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because that's hot. That's what's up. And I love it that you even thought enough to want to share that with other authors, you know, just to let them know. Because some of them just don't know. And
I'm very, very passionate about it. I'm trying to, the office that we just opened is more to balance my love for like fiction with nonfiction, because I really do. I'm at the age now where I want to just kind of branch out and really, I want to, you know, help others. So as much as I can help them, I'm so there for that. That motivates me more than, you know, sex on a page. I guess it's true. We all have our phases.
We all have our phases, right. I absolutely love that. Now, Lydia, as far as publishing, are you considered a hybrid author or indie author, or are you just completely traditionally published?
I'm hybrid. So I am published with Penguin Random House, mm-hmm. and I'm also self-published. And I also, some of my past books, like the McCulloughs, were originally published with small presses, and you know, a lot of the small presses went under in 2015 around that time. So I either pulled contracts for security purposes or they went under or whatever. And then I, you know, took them self rather than going traditional with them, and kind of, you know, because they've been established at that point and gives you a lot of freedom to say, well, I want this cover, you know, and because you lose a lot of that autonomy with the traditional publishing. But I'm definitely pro hybrid. Hybrid makes the most money statistically. Hybrid is, it gives you a lot of freedom to choose, you know, do you care about the cover right now, or do you care about, you know, the network you're going to connect to? And so it's there's a lot of options there.
I totally love that. That's what's up. Girl, yeah. Oh my God. So when you first was published, you know, so when you, because it was traditional first with a small press, mm-hmm. how long did it take before anyone said, girl, let me see what you're doing over here?
So my publishing story is kind of awesome. Okay. It's just one of those things where it's like, never assume that when people say, this is how it has to go, this is how it has to go.
Right.
I had been, you know, with small presses accepted, and I had the McCulloughs going there. I had my Newcastle series, a couple of things really like spinning, and I was very busy. I was constantly writing. I mean, like as new writers, just write as much as you can and invest in editors so that you can focus on writing. You know, it's, yes, you can. I know a lot of newbies who are indie will do their own editing, but like seriously get in there with your, you know, editors and let them go so you can do your thing, which is writing.
Right.
And then I was at Lori Foster's reading author get together. And I love Lori. I mean, like Lori is just an amazing, like amazing woman. Like I get such a kick out of her. Mm-hmm. So we were at RIGT and I was pitching to her agent on like, you know, the eighth floor of the hotel or whatever. And another writer had told me, go up and pitch to this agent. So I said, okay. So I had a pitch with me. And there was this little like adorable woman with great shoes across the hall. And she came out and asked me if I was so-and-so. And I said, no, I'm not. I'm here to pitch to the agent. And then when I finished pitching to the agent, she came out and she was like still looking for her appointment. And I had said, you know, hey, if your appointment isn't here, I would be more than happy to fill the slot. And she was from, you know, Berkeley with, it was just Penguin back then. So she was Berkeley's imprint. And I pitched to her and she got back to me and she said, you know, I really like your voice. I don't know if I like this story per se, but I want you to send me everything you're writing. So I had her card, which was like awesome. And I pitched everything I wrote, I just sent to her first, like, hey, check this out. Hey, check this out. And it was, I say like a year after I really started rolling that she got back to me. And I, you know, I had sent her so many things that she got back to me and she said, I just want you to know I'm totally digging this book right now. And I was like, oh my God.
Like, what?
I was just so shocked that like, she's reading it. Like, not she's in it. She wants to know if book two is available because it was a trilogy. And I said, yeah. So I sent it to her. And then like a week later, she called me and she emailed me and she said, can we have a meeting? And I said, sure. This was before Zoom. So everything was phone. And, you know, I called my mom and I was just like screaming. My mom thought that I was like, you know, and I'm like, no, you never said it. So, you know, I ended up getting this like 3-book contract on like the Surrender trilogy and everything. I mean, it was an amazing, amazing experience. And then like went from there. And I mean, it was just really cool. And then next thing you know, like a year from there, like Falling In, the first book of the series, was on the end cap between like Sylvia Day and like E.L. James. And I was like, oh my God,
I made it.
You know, it's so funny too, because you like go into the bookstore, like, you know, you go into your bookstore and you're like, oh my God, and you're like petting your book. And then you go up to the register and you give it to them. And they're like, do you want to sign up with the email? And you're like, sure. And you give them your email and you're like, it's Lydia at Lydia Michaels Books. And like nothing clicks. And then we're like, so you're like, okay, I took the stardom too far.
Okay, right. They're like, okay, cool. Girl, especially some young person, they're like, oh, they got the same name. Cool. Don't even...
But like nothing. So then my husband's like, they didn't recognize you. I'm like, I know. Can you believe that? But, you know, like that, like my story, that's why I always tell people, like, go through the door, get in the elevator, ask if you can. Like, you can't, don't wait for like an opportunity to knock on your door. Like, if you see an opportunity, you knock.
You knock.
You go after it. You get on the elevator. You push, you know, and amazing things happen.
I absolutely love it. And speaking of your books, it brings us to the first segment here at the Brown Book Series called Name That Book.
Okay.
We take a passage, a synopsis, a character, or something pertaining to one of your books, and you have to name that book. Okay. Now, if we give you a character, we meant the book that character is the star of.
Okay.
But you got a couple series here.
A little pressure because some of my books are like 15 years old.
I know, girl. I love it. You're going to get it. You're going to be great. I put my glasses on because, you know, I can't see. I was in the air this morning. I was like, they was like, Shay, your glasses are doing, you know, a glare. I was like, I can't see. So when the camera came back to me, like, oh, and here you go. It's Shay with the news. And I'm like, yeah, Bob, can you handle this real quick? So then you look at the comments, they're like, what is Shay going to say today? I'm like, yeah, I can't see. Between the glasses and these lashes, you know, I'll be having rough days. Pray for me. All right, Lydia, first up, name that book. This is one of my favorite series of yours. Okay, well, hold on. Let me get to you first. All right, here we go. You ready?
You're ready.
She's like, let's go, Shay, come on. right, first up, name that book. Take as long as you need, he rasped, betraying every insecurity raging inside of him. You're my guest.
Oh my gosh. Oh, that's like so obscure of a line. You're my guest. Okay.
You're my guest.
All right. So a guy is speaking.
Yes. All right.
A guy has a guest.
Mm-hmm.
Could be Surrender. Could be one of the McCulloughs. Could be. There's a lot of guests in my book.
A lot of guests. She moved in with him. She's like,
All right. I'm going to Surrender. Is it Surrender? No. Okay. Ah, oh, the mastermind.
Mastermind. The narcissist. Oh, I love this.
Elliot. All right. That was Elliot. All right.
You're my guest. He was so awkward.
This is so hard. I have 43 books. This is really hard.
I know. But you're doing great so far. At least, you know, you're getting. See? Keep going on your toes.
Okay. All right. Watch. I'm not going to. Oh, my gosh. Pressure's on.
Pressure's on. All right. This one is easy. Next up, character. Mallory Fenton.
Oh, that would be Beautiful Distraction.
That would be Beautiful. Yes, that's book two of your McCullough Mountain.
Yeah.
Series.
Originally titled Skin. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was originally titled Skin?
Yep.
Beautiful Distraction was?
Yep.
Girl, why?
Because she was uncomfortable in the skin she was in. So right. So it's so much about like Mallory just, you know, she's got this gorgeous lumberjack who like falls in love with her and she almost thinks it's like a prank or she doesn't get it because she's so just scarred and incapable of like self-love. And his love like teaches her how to like accept and love herself. I love that book.
I love that book too. I'm glad Skin was cute, but I like Beautiful Distraction.
No, definitely the new title is so much better.
Yeah, the new title was hot. Okay, cool. All right, next up, name that book. Now you warming up, girl. You warming up now, Lydia. On the outside, our life looks perfect. Inside, I'm screaming.
Breaking Perfect.
Breaking Perfect.
Yeah, that's y'all. Libby.
Getting it. Look, Ramsey say, oh, she's getting it now. I'm like, yes, get it, Lydia. All right, here we go. This is another series of yours that I love. Okay, I'm going to tell you. Well, here I go. You're going to love this too. This is awesome. I love this series. A deadly vampire is slaughtering mortal women in the woods, drawing unwanted attention from the media that threatens to expose their species.
So that could be, that's The Order of Vampires, but it could either be I think it's Dark Exodus.
Dark Exodus. Okay. Girl.
Because that guy's still on the run.
What?
I said that guy's still on the run in Prodigal Son, book three. So I did.
I love this series. I'm a charm angel kind of girl. So, but before we go on to the next one. Name them, but I need you to tell us a little bit about this series, the vampire book, because book three is coming out, right? The Prodigal Son.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Not until like November or something.
Yeah, it's gonna be at the end of the year.
Yeah, the girl. Year. Tell them a little bit about this series, please.
So The Order of Vampires, okay. I'm from Pennsylvania, so we live, you know, an hour away from Lancaster where all the Amish are and everything. And the one night, right. Me and my girlfriends were outside and we were drinking. It was like a girls' weekend and it was dark and this like eerie like mist was on the road and like the clip-clop of a horse going. It was this dark buggy and this like very good-looking Amish guy was like in there. And then my girlfriend and I, you know, we were drinking and we're sitting outside and I go, what if he was a vampire? And she's like, that's it, I'm going in. So that's where like the series came from because they're like using the Amish farm as like a cover for their secret society. So it keeps them, and it's not like, you know, hokey or Christian or anything like that. Like this is alpha, hot, high heat, very animalistic like tendencies. Like they are on a hunt for their mate and their mates are normally mortal. And they get this calling, so they don't dream normally. They start to dream, and once the calling starts, it's like a time starts, like a ticking time bomb. And they call themselves immortals. And the idea is, if you become a vampire, you're like feral, and you cannot be saved. you basically have such like extreme bloodlust for your mate that you will attack, rape, go after, maul any female or male or whatever your mate is. You know, they will go after anything searching for their mate's blood, because only their mate's blood can basically turn off this process. So they're becoming like more and more crazed. And that's everything. Each book has, you know, not just, and it's a very intricate series. So each book has not just one main character couple. It might have two or.
I love that too, though. I love that. That's what I love so much about this series. I'm like, wait a minute. It's like a soap opera. You're following different characters. I love that.
Because in the Order of Vampires, your arc they have to be read in order. I always say that. It's your arc is not one book. You're going to get your couple's happy ending, but you're also going to have lead-ons to what else is going on, because some stories are going on this big. I mean, the book five is like, that character is not even in book one, but that's what started the whole series, because what happens in book five, I was like, that's where I'm writing. So everything is so, and Prodigal Son is, oh my gosh, there's so, because Dark Exodus was so intense. I mean, Original Sin's the first one, super intense, very twisty.
But Dark Exodus was, girl, I had to turn my light on when I was in the bedroom. I started moving. I felt like somebody was moving. I'm like, are they coming looking for me? It was, girl, I cannot wait until the Prodigal Son come out. So it's more intense than Dark Exodus?
Yes. Well, Dark Exodus, yes. Mm-hmm. Because Dark Exodus is... there's a big part of the plot is that, you know, there's this feral vampire, they call it Fiesh. So there's this feral vampire who, you know, 80 years ago went looking for their mate and didn't find it. And they thought they killed him, and they didn't. And he's now like resurfacing, and, you know, these women are turning up murdered. And so they like the Amish, you know, setting, because it keeps the media away from them. It keeps, technology isn't a pressure for them to keep up with, because some of them are really old. But the older ones are very set in their way. So it's, you have a lot of almost that historic romance feel where, you know, you think in most vampire stories, you have to convince a woman like, okay, we're going to make you immortal now. And that's a decision. But now it's like, but we want you to wear this bonnet.
No.
And they're very modern, strong women. So I love the feistiness in there, and the older ones that try to like oppress them, and they get theirs too.
I love it. Oh my God. So we have to stay on the lookout for, first of all, ladies and gentlemen, you have to read book one and definitely read book two. And then we will be so excited when book three drop, because I can't wait. I cannot wait.
I'm excited. That's what I'm working on this summer, just finishing that up. And it's really exciting. Like, I keep going, you know, deep into that. And it's just a whole different world from Jasper Falls.
Yeah, you have to come back. You, when that book you read to drop, you have to come back. We need to do like a book release party or something, because I'm telling you, that book, this whole series, I love this series. I'm like, that one, this one and the nerdy series of yours, I just...
Oh, the mastermind.
I'm an inner nerd. So I love
it. I love a good nerd. Who doesn't listen? The brain is the most important organ in any man. So
yes. Right.
I don't care what anyone else says.
I don't care what they said. Right. I was like, he's a nerd and he's sexy.
Yes.
I love it. All right. Next up, name that book. Don't psych yourself out. You'll do great. Just be yourself. Good luck.
Oh my God. I know what this is, because I literally just.
You just saw it.
Is it? It's Side Squeeze. It's Side Squeeze. Yes, it's Side Squeeze. It's Giovanni talking to his sister Mariella.
You was like, you just wrote it. Lydia, you're like, the funny part was, he was like, I know this.
Alex is on summer schedule, so it's like a little slow, like, well, wait a minute.
I love it. Your latest novel, Side Squeeze, that is book 6 from your Jasper Falls series. Can you tell us a little bit about the Jasper Falls series in a whole, and then tell us about book 6?
I would love to. So Jasper Falls series, for this is, you can start right in Jasper Falls. Let's get it right off the front. You can read them all as standalones, jump in wherever you want. If you like reading books in order, the series definitely brings something when you read it in order, because the story builds collectively as it goes. Mm-hmm. For my readers who have been around since McCullough Mountain first dropped,
yes,
McCullough Mountain is about the McCulloughs on top of the mountain. Jasper Falls is the town at the foot of the mountain. So you have cameos, they're crossover series. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people start with Jasper Falls, jump into McCullough. Some people came from McCullough, go to Jasper Falls.
I came from Jasper Falls and went up the hill.
Yeah, and it works, right? Like, yeah, it's very interchangeable. So I'm loving that. And I think that, like, moving forward, all of my small towns are going to all interchange, because I love visiting and revisiting those worlds. And I hate ever saying that world's done. You know, I hate closing out series. But so Jasper Falls it's your small town romance. It's a lot of second chance romances, but not all second chance. It's a lot about like family stuff, but not like, it's focused on couples. And right. A lot of them have a lot of issues with their parents and things like that. So in Wake My Heart, you have, she's a town widow and she's very young and she's kind of reclusive now. And she moves in next, well, she gets a new neighbor who's Ryan Clooney from McCullough Mountain. He was like the perpetual bachelor in the family. He always went on terrible dates. And then you have the best man, which is his brother. And, you know, there's, so each story connects you to the next story. So there is like a, you know, follow the dotted line, but you could also jump in wherever. Now, Side Squeeze. So my favorites of the series are definitely My Funny Valentine and Side Squeeze, and they connect through siblings. Yeah. In the small town, you know, everyone's always like, I want to live in Jasper Falls. I want to live on McCullough Mountain. Yes. And it all seems great. But like Jasper Falls is like, well, what happens to the stuff we don't talk about? So in My Funny Valentine and Side Squeeze, you have Harrison Montgomery and Aaron Montgomery. And what I love about Aaron is that my betas were like, no, you can't do Aaron's story, because Aaron was the worst character in both series. She was
I was like, for a moment, I'm like, well, what's wrong with her?
And then we find out that in My Funny Valentine, her and Harrison's father was grossly abusive. I mean,
yes. Like,
extremely physically abusive. And the way that the small town would have these inklings, mostly the moms of the other couples, you know, that we meet, you know, we know a lot of the moms in the town, and the older moms, you know, when they were in school, would have these inklings of like, I don't know about, you know, Ward Montgomery, but the dads, see, Ward owned the hardware store. So the dads, you know, they could depend on him to open before a blizzard. He'd fix their screens and give them discounts on mowers. And he was their man. And he always had crumb cake and coffee. And it's so like indicative of how quickly we overlook that gut intuition about someone for something as simple as crumb cake. And
I'm glad you said that, though, because when I was reading it, like I said, I went to Jasper Falls first, then I went up to the McCullough Mountain to play with them boys up there, honey, with Frank and all them. But with Aaron, I was just like, something is up with her, and I don't know. I got a funny feeling about her dad, but then I was like, I'm like, something else happened. We're gonna find out something else happened with her to make her be the way that she is right now.
I mean, you know, they really like, they just, her and Harrison, this is where I love, like, I love writing a broken hero, and even more so, I think I love writing a broken heroine, because now our heroines in this like age are so strong, and they're not, you know, like, oh, you know, like they're strong and tough now. So it's okay to break them a little bit, because they're going to come back in the most badass way. So when you have like an Aaron and a Harrison, they're completely, they don't know how to love. They absolutely do not know how to love. They've never been loved. The only love they had was, you know, each other, this like platonic sibling love, but they were so untrusting because their mom abandoned them, their dad beat them. So them trying to love, they don't know how to receive it. Erin's thing is she can't handle intimacy. She can be sexual, but if it gets intimate, she's out. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Giovanni's a very intimate person. Like, he wants to look in your eyes and he wants to have pillow talk, and she is like out the door. So I like that. That's a perfect fit. And with Harrison, he was getting the brunt of the abuse at home. So he took off very young. And he has to come back because in both books, you know, we're dealing with Ward's funeral. He has to come back for his father's funeral. And he's very cynical about it, but he is there for Erin. Yeah. Him and Erin have a very estranged relationship, but his first love is there waiting. And she's always loved him, but he abandoned her. And oh, it's just second. I love, love, love the Montgomery saga in these books.
I love second chance love anyway. This is like my favorite trope. But I was just like, oh, Erin and Harrison. I love them. At first, I was all with Erin at the other, you know, but after I really got into her story, I was like,
And Erin really, like, I mean, if you're not sold on Erin by the end of My Funny Valentine, like by the end of Side Squeeze, I don't know. I don't know how you can't be, because she was like one of my favorites to bring into Side Squeeze. I mean, she was just so, you could see her growth so much, you know, like that evolution. Cause all of my books are character driven more so than like, I care more about the character development and their personal arc than I care about the plot and that arc. So I always focus on that first. So to see Erin, who was in, I mean, she was the bitch and, you know, Almost Priest, which was the first McCalla Mountain.
Yes.
She was Finn's girlfriend before Mallory came along in the second book of McCalla Mountain, which was Jasper. So we have watched this girl progressively just decay as like a kind human being.
Yes. I was like, something has to be wrong with her. And I'm so happy though that she got her own story. You know what I mean? Her own book. I'm like, okay. Right. Okay.
Yeah. So I think that's so cool though, because you know, we're in such a rush to tell the, you know, there's always that secondary character who's like the hot, funny guy, like the Kelly or, you know, Kane or like all these guys. Mm-hmm. And we're in such a rush to get to theirs. And the readers are like, we want that book. But I think that the characters that stick around the longest that you have this nice paced out breadcrumb trail of who they are and that is like my favorite thing as a writer. It's so rewarding when you get to their books because you know so much more about them than you really see on the page. You've read all between the lines about them and everything. I love that.
I mean, too. And I like the way that you wrote Erin's story to make her likable. She was like, she turned into like an Erica Kane. You know what I'm saying? It's like, oh, okay, then I see you, Erin. So like, and then you start to see the real beauty in her. Mm-hmm. And, you know, lying and stuff. And Giovanni was a perfect person for her. So
I really like, too, not to, like, obsess over Erin, but, like, I really love, too, because in Pining for You, which was the Christmas one, I think that's four. Jasper Falls. You have Skylar, who was a McCalla and she was part of that family. And she was like one of the kids in that series. And there's an age gap romance in Pining for You where it's, you know, the mayor and she's younger. But, you know, Erin worked with the mayor too. So her and Skylar clashed a lot and she was very mean to Skylar and vindictive. And, but when you see Skylar come to her and be kind, mm-hmm. and you're seeing, because in Pining for You, you're only in Skylar's perception and she's receiving this negative energy from Erin. But when you're in Erin's perception in My Funny Valentine and you see Skylar reach out to her and you see Erin struggle with, how do I receive this kind gesture? How do I, and she literally cannot, she can't do it. Like, she's trying to write a thank you note and she can't. She's struggling so much because she was never. And I think that's what I love about Jasper Falls, that these are real life things. Like, sometimes we don't like people and we don't realize they literally weren't taught how to interact properly.
Exactly. Exactly.
You're not even taught, but given those experiences, given those samples, those examples in life. And I feel like Jasper Falls and McCollum Mountain are so deeply rooted in the heart and experience of life and the human condition. I love going back to those stories.
Their stories was awesome. I loved it too. So I was like, yo, this is so freaking cool. And I love how you wrote the stories. I was like, it's like Dynasty in Dallas all in one. You know, like, this is cool. And I love that just where it is, like at the foot of the mountain, and then you go up the mountain, like, this is so hot. Like, so you got that on that one, girl. And speaking of hot, it brings us to the next segment here, the Brown Book series called Who'd You Rather? Well, we take heroes from your books, we pit them against each other, and you let us know who you want to have a one-night stand with.
Okay.
We ain't trying to get married to nobody, Lydia. We trying to hit it, quit it. If they want to leave us a little change on the nightstand, we go take it, okay?
All right.
All right. Here we go. First up, who'd you rather? Oof.
Lucian.
You going with Lucian?
Yeah, I mean, if it was like long term, Callan, but
okay, but since Hidden Quinn, I went with Lucian too.
Yeah, he knows what he's doing. Callan Shy.
Yeah, Lucian. I love his name. All right, so let's go on over. This is another series of yours. I love your Degrees of Separation series. So let's go in here. Who'd you rather? Austin or Court?
Well, see, like, that's like technically.
I said, what is December going to do?
Okay.
Come on, December. Who are you? Austin or Court? You go on Court?
He's just so sensitive. Although Austin's so intense, this is a really, really hard one because they're so paired up.
Literally paired up.
Literally, yeah. I just, you know, Cord, I just think he's so deeply, deeply embedded emotionally and like silly, you know, coffee filters and stuff. And he's just silly and he's kind of a little bit more of a kid. And I think that would be just more fun for a little romp. Especially if I had Lucian last night. I mean,
if you had Lucian last night, you need a little something, But no, girl, I went from Lucian to Austin. Let me tell you, girl, because I said, oh, he's upset. He is going to be, all his rage will come out.
Yeah, true. That's true. Yeah, I think I'm just tired from Lucian.
Bro, yeah, you still tired. You had to space them out, Lydia. You can't do back to back.
If you asked me this one first, it might have been Austin. Because that intensity, like, definitely draws me in.
Yes, girl.
So it's like the sweetness.
You still tired from Lucian. I get it. All right. Let's go on over here to your mastermind series.
That would be Mr. Stone all the way. Mr. Stone, blindfold away. Let's go. That would be Asher Roan. So Asher Roan's alias is Mr. Stone.
Okay. So she was like,
Asher Roan.
I'm going with Asher too. I'm sorry. I like girl.
Elliot's like more like, for me, like, Elliot's more of like a Sheldon personality. Like,
yes.
Kind of like that, like Michael P. Keaton.
Yes. Cooper. Rumbling around. I'll be like, never mind. Go get.
But he will find an algorithm to get the job done.
Yes. I don't got time for him to find one. I need him. I'm with you there. Okay.
Cool. He did his research in the beginning. He's good.
Yes, he did. That's a great. I love that series. Oh.
And he's a little angry too. So
he is very angry. Oh, I love Angry Man. Oh, Angry Man.
Mm-hmm, me too.
Yes, it's the best. All right, so now this is another series of yours. I love all your series.
Thank you.
I do. I just love them. This for different reasons though too. Like, you know, the masterminds, because you know I'm a nerd, so I love it. This is so cool. How they go get, you know, the Degrees of Separation. That girl, that December had me. I'm like, girl, where's she going? Like,
it was. Separation is probably one of my favorite series because it's for a trilogy. I can't compare my trilogies to my series because trilogy, you like read in order. Series, you can jump around. But Degrees of Separation is like, if you like, intensity. And like, if you know, like, all right, it's going to hit, it's going to sucker punch you, you know, like you're going to get emotional. You're going to be attached. You're going to be devastated, but you're also going to be like, it's going to get hot. It's going to get, you're going to feel a little betrayed. You're going to feel, you're going to feel all confused.
I was confused, girl. And I was, honey, for a split second, I got mad at Ms. December. Cause I'm like, where are you going? You just left him. Now you leave him a note. What? Girl, it was so much emotions for me. But then she did that to Austin. The Austin's on the floor. I'm like, oh my God, is he hallucinating? What happened? Okay. I'm all right now. But so I love that series. So here's another series of yours I love too. It's from the Newcastle series. Who'd you rather? Tyson Adams?
And that is a hard pick because Trent is big and rugged and just, you know, he lives in a barn. But Tyson, his eye, I mean, Tyson was my first, that was my first romance I ever wrote. So like, that was like, what is your fantasy man? And it was, I could still, like, I still picture him, like, physical form, just, like, as if I were Kat, and he's just giving you those eyes, like.
With Girl, I love it. So, Tyson, who, what star would put you in the mind of Tyson?
Oh, see, now I'm showing my age, because I can't think of his name. He's a musician, and he, like, works out a lot, God, and I'm so bad at pop culture, so I have no idea like what kind of this celebrity is in now in this age, because this is 15 years ago. Oh my gosh, it's not Usher. I want to say Usher, and it's not Usher. Oh my God. I'll have to come back to it. It'll come to me.
Come back to you. I was just like,
it'll come to me. He's so gorgeous, though.
Like, the way you described him was gorgeous in his book. I was like, who is she talking about? That man.
Yeah. Like, oh my God, this is driving me nuts. I can't believe I can't think of his name.
We'll come back to it, girl. We'll come back to it. Gorgeous. Right. Gorgeous. I went with Tyson, too. I was like, oof.
He's just, and he's so smooth and just patient. And
yes. Yeah, honey, yes, he's got a spirit on me and I'm gonna love it. All right, so now let's go on over to the Jasper Fall series. Okay, who'd you rather, Ryan Clooney or Gage King? Gage
Gage, just because I don't know, I like Gage. I like his spontaneity, I like his confidence. I love Gage comes in with all that billionaire confidence, but he gets down by like a country girl.
Love it, girl. Most billionaires do, honey.
I like his hammer shopping. He's got a lot of hammer jokes.
I went with Gage too. I did too, because I was like, after he, you know, do me, he can take me shopping. So yeah, I'm going to get it. All right. And last but not least, let's go on over to McCullough Mountain. This is a tough one. You rather? Colin or Finnegan?
Now, if I lined all the McCulloughs up, they aren't even in my top picks.
See?
Because it's a hard pick with that. But it would have to be, I think, Finn.
Okay.
I just, because all I think of with, I mean, Colin, though, Colin's good because he's taboo. He's just fighting, you know, like lust versus God. And
yes!
You know, he wants to be the priest, but he really wants to sleep with his brother's girlfriend. I mean, so there's so much rule breaking there that's hot and everything. And I do love Colin, but Finn is like written after my husband. So like, there's a love there.
Okay.
But if I had my pick of all the men, it would be Luke or Frank, the dad.
Yeah. You know, I was thinking about Frank. So I'm like, that's the daddy, though. We can't compare him to
the dad.
But his story, where it tells where it all came from, how it all happened.
Mm-hmm.
Baby, Frank ain't no joke.
No. Frank is serious. He knows what he wants, and he's getting it, and he's taking it. And I love if you go on to read what is that one? Kate's story. Intentional Risk. Like, that's like the prequel to the series. It starts it back over again.
Okay.
So that's like when he's got his first little girl. She's 17. And, you know, she starts dating, and like the, what he puts Ant through, like when Anthony comes into the picture with Kate.
Yeah.
I mean, he like walks him out to the woods and leaves him there.
Yes. Like, yes.
He is not, like, that is his baby. So like Frank, but then also Luke, because Luke is just so, he's my broken man. I mean,
Luke was fine. That's why I said, so we're not gonna use Frank, don't use Luke. Let's go play with the other little boys and see.
Yeah, but Finn's close to my husband. So like Finn, my husband's very much inspired two characters that I've written, and Finn's one of them. So the other one is Riley from Livy and Rose.
Yeah, okay. So
that's like my husband's silly side.
Oh, cool. I love it. Love it. Lydia, author's moments. What's your most urgent priority for the rest of the year?
Well, I would say it's to get a Prodigal Son where I want it by the end of summer so it can go off to audio production. And I really, you know, I have it written, but I really want to up it and give the readers, I want them to be blown away when they finish that book. So I'm just putting it on steroids, basically.
I love it. All right. That's in the literary world. What about in your personal life?
Oh, personal life? I would say really be present a lot, you know, like take some moments with my daughter. She's 2 years away from college now. So I'm really, like, I told her, I was like, no working this summer. I want you to read all the books you want, like Summer of Enrichment. Let's get outdoors. Let's, you know, so I can't wait. I'm a week and a half away from my best friend coming down for us just to have a solid week of no one else and beach and booze and books. And I need those moments. I am overdue. So I am so there for that. That's my urgent priority.
I love it. I'm with all of that. Author's moments. In being a novelist, what did you learn a little too late?
To take time and go at your own pace. Go at your own pace. Don't worry about how many books people are coming out with and how fast they're producing them. Do your books and do them at your own pace. If you want to produce books quickly in a row, write them and have them set aside, ready to go. But do not run yourself ragged trying to get there, because the quality of your work will suffer and your sanity will. I mean, like, life is too short. And this career, like in the book industry, such a marathon, not a sprint. Such a marathon. So just, if you're not enjoying it, do something else.
Listen, that's like one young lady, she was in a rut. And I was like, okay, she's like, well, I love romance, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, well, do a different type of romance. Do it right. Yep. Do, you know, something different. She was like, okay. So she's writing a romantic, like a suspense.
Yeah.
Like, yo, this is great.
I was you can definitely like shake the snow globe and settle somewhere else. I mean, one of my editors, I was burnt out, and it was after all the small presses has closed. I mean, that took a lot out of me, you know, like royalties were hijacked and it was a mess. Right. So when that happened, my editor, she was like, you need to, like, you're just burnt out. She's like, I want you to write. Don't think about what the market wants. Don't think about what's trending. Don't think about the rules that people said, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do this. And she's like, I want you to write according to just the voice in your head. Like, don't worry about, is it first person? Is it third? You know, like, she's like, take everything and throw it out. And she's like, just write something. Take 4 days and write as much as you can in 4 days. And in 4 days, I had a whole book. And it was the Calamity Rain book. So it was like, that's where my Calamity Rain came from. And it was funny because Calamity... she's like a 30-year-old hot mess who like has sexual mishaps and too much tequila. And she's the character who's like most inspired by like me. Like, if you strip away all the business, you know, we all have these facades. Like, if you take down the business facade, like this, like uncertain, you know, am I doing it right? Like, did I come off okay? And like all that unsurety, but like, at the end of the day, you just like giggle, like you just have to like giggle it out and laugh at yourself. And that's Calamity. And I mean, it was one of the most freeing books I've ever written, and it's hysterical. So, I mean, I highly recommend Calamity.
No problem. It's two in that series, right?
Yes. It's a rom-com duet.
Mm-hmm.
And readers want a third. They want the next part. So that's in the works. And, you know, but the duet is solid. So it's okay. You get the full thing, you know, you get the full thing first one, but there's a little lead on.
Yeah, I like that series too. I was like, oh my God, I'm like, I'm just in all her books. This just don't make no sense. All right. Author's moments. If you could have tea with one fictional character of yours, who would it be?
Of mine. Mm-hmm. Okay. I think that would either be, it would be a toss up, whoever was available first, which would probably be the woman. Maureen McCullough.
Okay.
Or I think it would actually be, because like, you know, to have the tea, you're getting the tea. And I want the tea. Maureen's got the tea. she's got all the tea. And then I think the other one would probably be Remington Davenport, who is the father in Calamity Rain. It's Hale's father. And he's just this billionaire, like cutthroat, like, and he's very dry and to the point and like, mm-hmm. you know, like just like, well, men have affairs and
yes.
you don't want to hear. And you're like, no, like he's just, and I think the reason I say that is because I think, you know, we have this thing where we're like, if you could have one gift, what would it be? And like my gift would always be to travel back in time so that I could have like lunch with any past member of my family, like any past member. And I think the Remington is so inspired by like my dad and like this, like, you know, like just like tell it as it is kind of guy. And like Maureen is so inspired by my mom and the aunts in my family and the women who contributed to my upbringing. So they're very like to sit down and have tea, you know, it's like, you want to, I don't know. That's like a moment where it's, you know, like to have a romantic dinner, it would be a whole different story.
Right.
Have tea. I want to go with the people who have the wisdom.
I get you on that. I totally get you on that. Speaking of people that have wisdom, dead or alive, if you were hosting a dinner party and could invite five people from any era, who would it be?
Oh. Dead or alive? Okay. Hemingway would be first on the list for sure. Okay. I love me some Ernie. Dead or alive? Okay. Anthony Hopkins. I'm like totally fixated on him, have been since I was a little girl. Keanu Reeves, because he is just amazing, amazing personality, absolutely outstanding. Michelle Obama, because she's just the queen of the world in my eyes. And let's mix it up, like Anne Boleyn.
I love it. All right, cool. Lydia. This has brought us to the end of our interview. We have one question left. But before we ask this last question, I just want to say thank you for joining me. Thank you so much.
This was so fun.
Thank you. But before we ask our last question, tell everybody all things Lydia. Where can they get your latest novels? Where can they get all your stuff, all your social media handles, websites, and all the other good stuff?
Okay, so all of my books are for sale. Basically, wherever books are sold, you can, if they're not at your bookstore, you can definitely have them order them in for you. So Barnes & Noble, Amazon, all of that, on all the platforms, Google, iBooks, all of that, Kobo. I'm most active on Instagram. Every week I do a giveaway, signed paperback. My handle on Instagram is at Lydia_Michaels_books. TikTok, I'm starting with TikTok, so you know I'm there. I don't know how entertaining it is. That's at Lydia Michaels. Facebook at Lydia Michaels. Twitter at Lydia_Michaels. So we all wish they could all be uniform, but they're not. My books are all going into audio right now. So if you are in an audio kick, I have some really binge-worthy series that you can plow through on audio, and my narrators are chef's kiss.
Okay, because you know we love a nice narrator, honey. We love a good narrator. They make the book come alive.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Gotta have a lover. All right, here we go. Lydia, last question of the interview. If you were writing a book about your life, what would the title be?
Yeah. My first book that I wrote was about my life. And it was called Monster in My Closet. And the first line of the book is, some people keep a skeleton hidden in their closet. I have a monster hidden in mine. So I'm going to leave you at that, because one day it'll be out. You can figure out what it is.
I absolutely love it. Brown Book Series. Give a round of applause for Miss Award-winning and best-selling author, Miss Lydia Michaels.
Thank you so much. This was beautiful. Great interview. Thank you. I had a blast.
Thank you so much. IBBS, y'all know how we do. Every Wednesday night, 7 p.m. Let everybody know that we're going to be here at 7 p.m. every Wednesday night. Tell a friend, tell all your friends to go and check out everything that Lydia Michaels has written. Everything, all of it. I will not steer you guys wrong. Everything that has Lydia Michaels' name on it, you're going to want to get it. And you definitely want to get Jasper Falls and McCullough Mountain Series, because, baby, I love it over there. All right, you guys, love you guys. Y'all be good. Stay safe. But most of all, stay positive. Until next time.